These last few weeks has been, the headlines have not been the best as we look at Paris, we look at Colorado Springs, and now we look at San Bernardino. And it makes us think about life a great deal. Makes us reflect, maybe appreciate, and maybe even be fearful. And that's the first reading today from the book of the prophet Baruch. People of Israel had been taken prisoner. Their cities had been destroyed. Their families had been led away in exile. It was a very tragic time for the people of Israel. There was death and destruction. There was isolation. There was separation. There was exiles. There was probably people, immigrants coming from everywhere, but most of the people lost their families. And then today, and Baruch comes and he has something new to say. It's a hopeful message. And he's basically telling these people who are probably basically destroyed, any hope of the future is taken from them. And he tells them, take off your robes of mourning and misery and put on the splendor of the glory of God. And those words should not, in a sense, echo hollow in our hearts, especially in the world we live in today. Because we're being asked to trust in God. Now, Baruch, beautifully, poetically, whatever way you want to say it, is telling the people that God has changed everything. Your valley of tears has been filled over. The mountains of pains and sorrows have been flattened. So things are different. They're hopeful. There's a message of hope. In the gospel, we have a whole different instruction from Luke. Kind of problematic. It's like a very big proclamation. The very first line, in the 15th year of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was the governor of Judea, when Herod was the tetrarch of Galilee. And well, you know all those names. We know them as the political leaders. We hear their names over and over again in the gospel. But then Luke takes it away from us by simply saying, that's not important. What's important is that a voice cries out in the desert, proclaim the way of the Lord. And that too is maybe what we need to be aware of. Are we truly listening to the voice of the Lord? Are we truly preparing the way of the Lord? And it's not because we have to do anything fantastic or big or brilliant, but we have to walk the way of the Lord. And that voice, we are being told, won't be found in the political figures, even Pontius Pilate, Herod, not even the political figures of our day will the voice be heard. Not in the rich and the famous, not in the powerful, but the voice will be heard in the desert. The voice of John the Baptist, the homeless man who is proclaiming the way of the Lord. Are we listening to the word of God? Do we hear the word of God? This coming week on Tuesday, Pope Francis is going to proclaim a year of mercy. And we do need mercy. Mercy sometimes is that bridge that connects God to us, helping us to believe, or opening our hearts to that belief, that hope. that we too can experience God's love and mercy and forgiveness unconditionally in our lives. So much of our lives are filled with so much vengeance, hatred, anger, frustration. But do we really truly connect ourselves to the mercy of God? And that's so important. Because if we're not connected to the mercy of God, we're not even connected to God. So as we begin this year of mercy, are we ready and willing to make God the center of our lives? Are we willing to listen to the voice crying out in the desert? The voice that would mean nothing to us because we're so busy. It doesn't mean enough to us because it's so impractical. It doesn't mean enough to us because it doesn't make sense. But it will make sense if we listen quietly to that voice of the Lord. There are three basic gifts that we receive in life. The gifts of our faith. Tonight we have the sisters here. A lot of you went to Catholic school. And we have a lot to give gratitude to God for what these sisters did for us. But have we truly enkindled that faith in our lives? You know, I often think Catholics received only one gift of the Holy Spirit. You know what that gift is? It's not wisdom, understanding, counsel, fortitude, piety, courage, or the fear, but it's the fear of the Lord. We go around, in a sense, disconnected from God. We're afraid of God. But we're called to enkindle our relationship with the Lord. Pope Francis calls us and tells us the first thing we need to do is to fall in love with Jesus Christ. And that's not just a simple love, it's in a sense trusting, opening your very heart and soul to the Lord. You only have to open the scriptures and you see the lives of the disciples even. Opening their hearts to God. Old Testament, over and over again, those opening their hearts to the Lord, enkindling their faith. We're not motivated by fear, we're motivated by love, the love that Christ has for us. No wonder the person that's the most obvious person today in the world, the most popular, the most unique person is Pope Francis. Simply because he loves the Lord. Forming Christian leaders. The Lord has gifted us with Francis. Last week he went to Africa, Uganda and Kenya, and he went to the Central African Republic, the most dangerous country in Africa today, paraded around in an open car, but he didn't do it on his own. He had the Muslim leader with him, the Pentecostal leader with him, to show the people that there is a way to know and love each other. There is a very important thing to all of us to realize. God is not the God of hatred, vengeance, and violence. God is the God who has created us. God is the one who has given us life. Finally, harmonizing. How do we harmonize our lives? If we don't have peace within our own hearts, how can we make decisions of life? We're all frustrated, angry with one another. But unless we truly let the peace of Christ come into our hearts, how can we say we know the Lord? We call ourselves a Eucharistic people. The Eucharist, one body, one bread. We hear the prayer of Jesus over and over again in the Scriptures. I pray that they may be one. I come from Ireland. One of the saddest things of growing up in Ireland was when you had Christians fighting Christians. And until people sat down and realized that they sat at a table and realized the person they were talking to was really a person. They weren't demons. They weren't outer space cadets. They were simply human beings. One of the greatest gifts, I remember speaking one day to our rabbi in New York. He simply said to me, "The God in me greets the same God in you." Until we realize that in a real sense, that God is the God of love that inspires. When we let hatred and vengeance happen and come upon us and come into our life, then religion does not become religion because it's not God. Pope Francis has shown us that. He has shown us that over and over again. Unless we make room in our very hearts and souls for the presence of God, then we are nothing. Tonight, I pay tribute to these lovely sisters. And I say over and over again, are we a joyous people? Who are the people that we admire? Who are the people we believe in? Who are the people that truly inspire us? And Francis is the person that most people today admire. Last week I was at UCF. There were 5 young people there who graduated from universities around the country. Really enthusiastic, passionate about their love for God. And yet they were working. They are going to work at UCF for 1 year. They're not being paid. They have to earn their own keep, but they want to give back to young people the gift they received in life. And that's the joy of the gospel, the message of Francis. I can pick on these sisters here, and I can pick on each and every one of them. And I can pick on this sister here. Do you want me to tell them who you are? This is Sister Immaculata. Come here, sister. I shouldn't do this because she wants the microphone.
Thank you, Bishop. It's always nice to, you know, get the spotlight.
Oh, my God.
You're used to it. I'm not.
That's not true. She's used to it. I'm afraid what she's going to say next. Turn around, let them all see you, because I know if I have to run away.
If I go up to the microphone, it might be better.
No, you better stay here, because I can hold you here.
Thank you. I hope my mother is looking down, because she always wished that I would be in the arms of a good man. But thank you, Mother. No, Bishop, I know that in the bulletin, Father Richard, well, let me go back, because the sisters have been coming here for how many years now, Father Richard, since
four
he began,
years.
4 years. And each time we come, we feel like we are goddesses, that we have been elevated to such a rank, and it humbles us greatly. But we want to thank you, Bishop, for making it happen, for the people of the parish, for, first of all, Father Richard, who always shows great reverence for us. Father Richard and his brother John were nurtured by the church in my area, where I am ministering now, in Our Lady of Lourdes in Melbourne, Florida. And I believe his mother said, always be nice to the sisters. And he certainly has done that. But Bishop, I want to tell them a story about Sister Veronica. if you have time to let me do it.
Yes, you have the microphone.
This is in conjunction with your giving to the second collection for the retired religious. Sister Veronica was a wonderful young sister. Just, you've seen some of the young people here tonight, the young sisters. I'm one of the elderly. As a matter of fact, I was going to say I'm very happy to be here tonight. As a matter of fact, I'm happy to be any place at my age, as long as it's above ground. Sister Veronica was a young novice in this convent back in Ireland, and she was just, one morning she got a letter from her brother, and she read it, and she was so thrilled. He was saying beautiful things like, "We're so happy, Veronica, that you've chosen to be the bride of Christ, that you've given your life to the Almighty." And she was really feeling so, you know, warm and fuzzy. And then she looked in the envelope, and there was a $50 bill. And she thought, the icing on the cake, after he's told her all these things about the family really being happy with her. And as she's reading it, she looks out and she sees a homeless person at the gate of the convent. And she thinks, here I am, beautiful convent, lovely sisters as companions. Well, not all of them, but some. And she thought, I know what I'll do. I'm going to give the $50 to this man. So she writes a little note. She says, "Don't despair, Sister Veronica." And she goes out, gives it to the gentleman. He doffs his cap, thanks her profusely, goes off, and she feels very warm that she has done such a thing. Like you're going to feel when you put that check in the envelope. And she thought, oh, I really feel good about doing that. Next day, at lunchtime, the sister who was in charge of the door came in, brought an envelope to Sister Veronica, and was chock full of, she could see $100 bills, 20s, 10s. She's looking, I can't believe, what is this? And then she looks, there's a little note inside, and it simply said, "Don't despair, came in at 100-1, love, Dave." And we're all betting on you that you will make us comfortable in our retirement. Thank you.
You see now how the sisters are. They're so sad and they're so weak and they're so lonely. So the joy of the gospel is still alive in their hearts, and we are truly blessed to have them with us today. So thank you all.